but you can't forget from sundown to sunset. Nah, nah. It's all in the air, you hear it everywhere. No matter what you do, it's gonna grab a hold on.
Yeah, I came here, and I think it was 71 with the Cal Basie band, and I stayed.
So you've seen everything then?
Well, I've seen a lot of building going on, yes, and of course all my grandkids were born here, so.
Well, that's great. Okay. Well, let's get right into it. You know, this is the 40th anniversary of one of the big songs in your career, A California Soul. Can you talk about that song and what it means to you?
Well, actually, it was just a fun song that I enjoyed doing at the beginning. And since it's had a rebirth with the movies and you know, everything that's been going on with it, with commercials, et cetera, of course, I've enjoyed it much more. I think the hardest part about the song is because I either work with trios or a big band here in the States. So the only time I really do get to perform it so that it's even close to the recording is when I'm in Europe and Japan, when I use, five or six pieces.
I see.
Yeah, and it's kind of exciting, I have to say, that the musicians, you know, know the song from the CD. I believe, the CD called The Anthology.
Right.
Was put out by Soul Brother and out of London. And I have to tip my hat a lot to the jocks who played it on the floor, you know. Get up and dance!
and I guess by extension, it's also the 40th anniversary of your album, The Spice of Life.
Is that right? Okay. Well, you know, the thing is, I know that I've been working approximately 50 years, so it's kind of hard to separate when you did this or when you did that. Even
yeah.
as I'm writing part of my history, I can't get a lot of the dates right, so.
Okay. Well, that's very interesting. So you're writing a book?
Yes, I am.
Any details? When is it going to come out?
Honey, when I finish writing it, let's put it like that.
That's a great answer. Well, you don't want to leave anything out. You've had a long and successful career.
I'm telling you, it's a surprise. You know, I mean, I'm very, very blessed. I'm not at all unhappy. I have no bitter pills to swallow, and even if they were, whatever feelings I may have had 25 years ago or what have you, I can't remember that. You know, who wants to remember angst?
Yeah, that's true. But from what I've seen, from what I've read, you were quite an adventurer. You were doing your thing and really trying to get aboard. And you've kind of fought some stops along the way before you finally settled in. I think it was in '66. When you signed with...
I settled in on... What do you mean?
When you landed with the... the Playboy Club in Chicago?
Oh, uh-huh, right.
That was
around... Even in those days, come on, we worked where we could work. There was nobody planting the garden for you on your way through. You know, you had the only information, if you wanted to know something, you read other people's biographies, or, you know, I read Ella and Lady Day and whatever I could read about them. But it's an interesting kind of a dichotomy with me, because I really wasn't looking to be in show business. I was just trying to make a couple of dollars, you know, for the weekend and make some money for the kids' extra things like shoes, clothes, and food, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But
the luxury items,
that's why I say I've been blessed, because I never really had an agent for a long time. It was mostly word of mouth, and Joe Williams was very, very instrumental in telling people about me and It was just amazing, my early beginnings. But I also got information from an uncle who helped to raise me. He was a jazz musician.
Right.
And, really, he told me more horror stories than, than anything. Years ago, I think my family was so interested in telling you what not to do. They didn't mm-hmm. realize that there were some things they had to tell you to do.
Yes, yeah.
So that's what made you have to fend your way through, and I was, I guess, a kind of a little rebel person to begin with. So if I didn't like what somebody was telling me, I just didn't listen. Move along, Can you curb that information, okay?
Yes, I can.
The other thing I would look at is like, well, you don't seem to be doing so damn good yourself.
Yeah, that's right. You turn it around. That always works. I don't see no crowd around you neither.
Hello, thank you.
Well,
I think in those early days, there were a lot of people who were confused as to the fact that they had an office and, it was sort of kind of like, doesn't this author tell you something? No.
So were you naturally trained as well then? Like, you didn't take any formal training, or?
No, I never did. I think, as a kid, I'm sorry, I'm not going to try. I hope you don't hear this. I had to turn my coffee on.
Oh, no worries.
I had one lesson on piano from a neighborhood lady. Who hit my hand with a ruler, and like I said, one lesson, I was the end of her, and I won my 50 cents back,
About $500 today.
Yeah, baby. And I never really took a voice lesson at all until maybe about 20 years ago. I found that I was getting hoarse, and things were happening with my voice. And I went to a local person here in Las Vegas, and she said, well, I can't really teach you anything, but I'm going to put this down on a tape, and you just follow these things, which was mostly breathing. I had gotten into bad habits.
Okay.
Okay, coffee's made.
Awesome.
Okay.
What kind of coffee, by the way? Are you a connoisseur?
Nah. Hot.
Okay, well, that's good. Dark and hot?
No, I just drink, whatever. I think my husband just, whatever he likes, I like. That's the way that goes. I really just love the smell of the coffee.
Wakes you up.
And lately, if I have to do one of those tours where I have to be up at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, I do find that a little coffee makes me, it's probably in my head. I have a little more energy to do whatever it is I have to do.
Okay.
Because one morning I was there in London, I'm going to say 6 or 7 years ago, and we had a very early flight, so I just kind of took a shower as soon as I got in and put the clothes right there, that kind of thing. And you say, okay, I'm going to sleep for 4 straight hours. And, man, within 2 hours, I always sleep with the TV on, and I could hear me singing. So I woke up, and it was the one of the commercials for KFC. And I was singing it. I don't know what it is, but, boy, when I hear me sing, I jump up. I don't know.
Like a radar or something, just...
Yeah, right? I've had a few of those instances where I didn't know that something had been recorded or placed in commercials.
Yes.
I was home alone a few years back after they used... it was my live version of Woman of the Ghetto, which was sampled. And I believe this sampling was done from a young man out of out of Glasgow.
Okay.
That one. Remember me, I'm a runner as your baby, yeah. That kind of thing. I was home alone and I was watching, I love football. I was watching the football playoffs and all of a sudden I heard me singing and I said, oh my goodness, the blood just came out of my face, my body, and my son was standing on the porch ringing the bell and I could see him through the window and I was motioning him to come in and I'm pointing to the TV.
Mm.
Finally, it dawned on me he didn't have a key. And he said, oh, wait a minute. I've heard that on radio. I didn't know that was... I told somebody that was my mother.